Good afternoon and welcome. I'm John Otten, the Royal Ambassador Consultant for Kentucky WMU and Kentucky Baptist, and it's time for our Royal Ambassador lesson and Campcraft activity for the month of February. I'm back outside. It's a little cold and windy today, but it's not too bad of a day, and after doing 3 months inside, I think it's been 3 months, I just wanted to get back outside and do something outside. And so here I am, and so I'm back in my front yard, and you'll hear some cars going by. I hope they're not too loud, and you'll be able to hear everything that I'm saying, but we're going to do this here in the front yard. So for our lesson this month, I want to start with the Bible story. It's found in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 41. Now, I'm not going to read all of that. In fact, what I'm going to do is, in our RA World magazine on page 37, there's a paraphrased version of the story that's found in the Bible in Acts chapter 2. And I'm going to read that for you today as we start our lesson. So the story is called Help Has Arrived. And like I said, it's on page 37 in our RA World magazine. So it says, all the believers were together in one place. It was the day of Pentecost, a harvest festival. Suddenly they heard a sound coming from heaven. The believers wondered what it was. The sound was like a very strong wind. It was so loud that it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Then the believers saw something that looked like tongues of fire. The flames moved towards them and rested over each of them. The believers were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to talk in other languages. They were speaking languages they didn't know. There was a crowd watching and listening, and they were from many different countries, and the people in the crowd realized that they could hear in their own language what the believers were saying. They were amazed and bewildered, and they asked, "What does this mean?" So Peter stood up and he said, "Let me explain. God's Holy Spirit has made it possible for us to tell you about Jesus." Then Peter told the crowd about Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And when the people heard, their hearts were filled with shame, and they asked, "What should we do?" And Peter said, "You must turn away from your sins and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then your sins will be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." That day, about 3,000 people believed in Jesus and were baptized. Now, that's a pretty exciting story, and that comes in the time very soon after Jesus had died and risen again, and the believers were told, they were promised they would receive the Holy Spirit. And we see here in this passage how God began to work in the lives of those first believers to give them the ability through His Spirit to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And that's one of the truths I want us to be sure to notice here, is that it was only after they had received the Holy Spirit that those first believers were able to be the kind of witnesses that God wanted them to be. This is true for us today as well. When we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, God will forgive us of our sins. He creates in us a new life, and He gives us His Holy Spirit to help us be witnesses for Jesus. Now, we may not hear a rushing wind. We may not see flames of fire up over our head. We may not speak in other tongues. That doesn't happen real often. But we will see evidence of the Spirit at work in our lives when we put our faith in Jesus. And that's another truth I want us to see, is that when the Spirit enters the lives of a person who's put their faith in Jesus, the Spirit changes them. Their sins, yes, are forgiven. They're given a new life. And then they're given power to do the things that God has called them to do. You also see that change in other people's lives. When they hear the gospel and they believe in Jesus and the Spirit fills them, you see a change in their lives as well. And in our Campcraft activity today, I hope will help us think about this. The Spirit is kind of like in a sense, the wind. You can't really see the wind. You can't see the spirit. But we see evidence of the wind. The leaves blow and things like that. We see evidence of the spirit, quote, blowing in the lives of believers and changing them and empowering them to do God's work. So what we're going to do today is we're going to make a weather vane. And this activity is found in the nature section of the Campcraft manual. That Campcraft manual can be downloaded on kywmu.org/campcraft, and you can download that for free. And this weather vane, you can find the instructions for it on page 175 in the Campcraft manual. Making this weather vane is one of the requirements for the Discoverer 3 patch. Now I'm going to show you the things, talk you through the things that are needed to make this weather vane, but I'm also going to show you how I did it a little bit differently, and I'll tell you why I did that. But first of all, what you need, you're going to need some cardboard, some kind of heavy cardboard. I've got some here that I've already cut out and made a arrow out of. You're also going to need a nail, a long nail, and I've got one here. I believe this is a 16 penny nail. So you're going to need a nail. You're going to need a wooden spool. Like I said, these are the instructions in the book, and I'll tell you how I'm doing it differently. But here's some little wooden craft spools, a little bag of those. You're going to need a long stick about 2 inches by 2 inches, and somewhere between 4 and 6 feet long. I went to the hardware store and I bought a tomato stake. Now it's not 2 by 2, it's more like 3/4 of an inch by 3/4 of an inch. So it's not as big in across the midsection, but and I got one that was 4 feet because I felt that would work best for the video today. But you'll need something like this for your weather vane. You also need a permanent marker like that. You'll need some scissors. Got a pair here. You'll need a hammer. And you will need a compass. And I've got my compass right here. Now, the instructions in the book tell you to make an arrow out of your cardboard. And so I've done that. Kind of just drew one out using a ruler and a pen and drew that out and then cut it out. And then it tells you to take your nail and put it through. You'll notice in cardboard there's like these little tunnels that run through, and you'll want to make sure you orient your arrow on the cardboard so that those are running this way across your cardboard, not this way. If they run this way, you're not going to be able to do this, but you want them to run this way. And then you'll take that nail and you'll put it down through one of those tunnels. Like that. Now you'll notice that's really tight. It doesn't turn real well. Okay, so that was one of the things I ran into, is that the nail I have is real tight in there, and it's going to make it hard for this to spin. The second thing I thought about with the cardboard is that when it rains, this is going to get ruined. And I thought, what can I make my arrow out of that would be better in the rain? And so I thought of foam. Craft foam that many people use to make different things. And so I got some craft foam as well. And the foam I got is 9 millimeters thick. You'll see one piece of that there is 9 millimeters thick. And I also got a drinking straw and some duct tape. And so what I did, I took my cardboard arrow and I traced it onto my foam and I cut out two of these. And then what I did is I cut my straw to be the same width as my arrow here, and I cut it off, and then I taped it to one of the arrows, and you can see right there I've got it inside. And then I used my duct tape to do that, and I thought I'm just going to tape the other arrow to it so it's sandwiched in between there like that. And so I used my duct tape here and here, just kind of wrapped it around and kind of made a sandwich out of it. And so I feel like that'll be a hold up better in the rain, seeing as it's made out of foam and duct tape. And so that's my That's my arrow. And then the straw, I made sure the straw I picked out left a lot of room right here for my arrow. And so you'll see that it spins a lot easier. And that's really important for your weather vane. The other thing I realized is the length of my nail. If I put one of those wooden spools here before I nail it into the end of the stick, I'm not going to have any nail left to go into the stick. And so instead of that, what I did was I got a couple of washers. And these washers are called fender washers. I got two small ones. They make them bigger, but the thing that's interesting about these fender washers is no matter how big the washer is, the hole in it is always small like that. And that's what I wanted, something that would just right fit there around my nail. And so I got two of them so that I could set them up against each other like this, and they kind of serve as almost like my bearing for my arrow to turn on. And it also left me plenty of nail to nail into the stick. So now that I've got that made, I've got my stick, and what I did here on the end where I'm gonna nail it, first of all, you'll notice there's a hole already in there. With this, if this was a 2x2, I wouldn't worry about it, but the fact that it's only 3/4 inch by 3/4 inch, I was a little worried that when I nailed the nail into it, I would split it. And so what I did was I went on and took a smaller nail and nailed kind of like a pilot hole in there. And then now I can nail a slightly larger nail in there. So I've got the nail in there, or the hole in there, and then I marked on one side in for north. And then on the opposite side of north, so I got north, on the opposite side you want to put south. And then knowing where to put east and west is you just hold the stick in front of you, so here's north facing that way, and then east would be this way. And so I wrote east here, you can see it there, and then I wrote west on this side over here. Now, this is where the compass comes in, because when you set this up in your yard, you want to set it up so the end is facing north, so that your stick is oriented correctly. Just a quick word about, got that right in front of my face, quick word about where to put your weather vane. You could put it out in the middle of the yard, but one, it's going to be in the way probably for when you're mowing grass or things like that, or your dad's mowing grass. And so my thought is that probably it'd be best to put it in a corner of a flower bed, or maybe you have a garden in the summer. And it's my neighbor hollering at me over there. So I'm going to put this in the middle of my yard back here behind me, but in most cases I would probably put it in like one of my flower beds or in my garden or something like that where it's out of the way. So I'm going to stand up here, back up a little bit so you can see. So I'm going to set my compass. I'm going to put the in, and I'm going to line the in up with the direction of travel arrow. And then I'm going to put it here, like I've shown y'all in a video before, put it right here at my belly button, and I'm going to turn until the magnetic arrow lines up with the orientation arrow in the bottom of the housing, which is right here. So north is that direction, so I'm going to take this stick and put it right here so that the end is facing north. The ground's really soft today because of the snow and rain we've had. So I'm literally just pushing this down in the ground with my hand. If the ground's harder, you might want to use your hammer or a mallet, a rubber mallet. That way you don't tear up the top of the stick. But anyways, I've got it. Let me make sure I've got it oriented right. All right, I'll twist it just a little bit. There we go. That's facing north. Now I take my weather vane arrow, and I don't know how well this is going to go. The ground's so soft, I may end up just beating the stick further down into the ground, but put that right on there. and nail that in. You don't want it too tight so that it pinches the arrow. So it's going to spin like that. Now, where I'm standing today, there's not a lot of wind. My house is over here and it's blocking the wind. If I was around the side, it would do a little better, but you can kind of see it turning there a little bit. If I move it over here, see what it does. You might even could put like a little drop of oil there. There it goes, got a little gust of wind. So if I was in my backyard, back over here, I'd get a little truer direction of the wind. As it is, where I'm standing right now, the wind comes between my house and my neighbor's house, comes in between there and around the corner. And so it's affecting that direction a little bit. But the arrow points in the direction that the wind is coming from. So basically, as I've been pointing over here in this direction, that's where my house is and the gap between it and my neighbor's house. You can see their garage over there. The wind's coming from between the houses over there and blowing this way, and some of it's coming over the top of the house. But basically, if I was to look at my, there's north here and west here, the wind's kind of coming from the north to northwest, which means it's blowing this direction. Blowing this direction, kind of south, southeast, okay? So if I had this out away from the house a little bit further, it would give a little bit better of a reading, but the house is affecting that a little bit. But that's how you make a weather vane. If you wanted to, you could probably put a little drop of oil there in between those two washers, and that would help help them, one, stay clean, and two, help them glide a little bit better on each other. But that's how you make just a real simple weather vane, and that'll help you know. Again, the arrow points in the direction that the wind is blowing from, and then the tail of it points in the direction the wind is going to. From and to. All right, and if you need help with that, you could draw a little arrow on here, and you might write here on this end, wind source, and you might put over here where this little drawn arrow is, if you want to draw one in there, you might write wind direction, okay? So the source, this points at the source of the wind, this points in the direction of the wind, okay? So you see my wind's pushing around and coming over my house a little bit more now, but it's pretty erratic as it moves around the house. So anyways, that's how you make a weather vane, real simple. Anybody can do that, and put it in their yard and watch how the wind affects that weather vane and moves it around depending on where the wind is coming from. Like I said earlier, we know the wind is blowing because of the effect that it has on things. We can feel it on our skin. We can see the leaves and the branches moving. And so that helps us to know with our weather vane. It helps us to read that wind more carefully and see where it's coming from and where it's going to. And like I said earlier, we know that the Spirit is blowing or moving in the lives of believers because the direction of their life has been changed. And now they are living for Christ and sharing the good news. We can see evidence of God's Spirit at work in our mission story as well. This month, our missionaries are Tom and Tina Ferguson. Tom is an ethno-arts consultant who helps other missionaries in Africa to share the gospel. They live in South Africa, but Tom travels all throughout sub-Saharan Africa, studying how different cultures express themselves through music, drama, storytelling, and dance. And then what he does with the information that he learns about those cultures and the way they use the arts, he then helps the missionaries and the pastors and other Christians learn how to tell people about Jesus using these different arts and cultural expressions. And as they work together to do this, we can see the Holy Spirit at work. And I'm going to read for you a couple of examples of that. And again, this comes from our RA World magazine. This time I'm on page 41. And let me read for you, not the whole part of it. I just want to begin. And it says here, Tom trains local believers how to tell the stories of Jesus in a way that people can understand them using their language. This project is called Story Together. Now, Morio lives in the Democratic Republic of Congo. He was part of a cult-like group, but he attended a Story Together workshop. At the workshop, he heard the stories of the Bible and became a follower of Jesus. He told the stories to his family, and they also became Christians. Soon, a church was started because of the Bible stories. They built a church building where they now meet three times a week. Now, Morio is on a team that crafts stories of the Bible to share with others. So see what I'm talking about? You see evidence of the Spirit at work there. As the Spirit helps Tom and the other missionaries learn about the culture and the arts expressions and then use that as a vehicle for sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, people like Morio hear the gospel. They believe in Jesus and become followers of Jesus, and then they go out and tell others, and those people believe, and the next thing you know, they've started a church, and they're continuing to share the gospel. So that's one of the stories that we see in the life of our missionaries, Tom and Tina Ferguson. There's another one here I want to read for you very shortly. It says, Tom leads workshops to help believers create new songs to praise and worship God. These new songs use the style of music and instruments that are familiar to the people. The songs are sung in the language that the people know. Tom has helped create new songs among believers in more than 50 people groups in Africa and Asia. Now, he says, what Tom enjoys most about his work is watching people use the music and instruments from their own cultures in worship for the first time. Tom says there's such celebration and joy that it is hard to describe. Now, listen to this. It says a missionary, and this is a different missionary than Tom, but it's a missionary that Tom has worked with. A missionary who works with the Toposa people of South Sudan shared this report with Tom. This missionary says, one day I went to visit one of my friends. While we were working in the garden, I heard someone singing. It was my friend's brother. He was guarding the fields, and he was singing one of the Bible stories that the believers had created during the workshop. I asked him where he had heard the song. He said someone taught it to him a few nights before. The Bible story songs are moving quickly through our community. There again is another evidence of the Spirit moving through the lives of believers and moving the gospel story, in this case in song, to people who speak other languages. And so we see evidence of the Spirit moving and working through the lives of Tom and Tina and the work that they do and in the lives of these other missionaries and pastors and believers who are sharing the gospel throughout sub-Saharan Africa. So that's our lesson for today, and I hope you've enjoyed it, and we'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.